monthly period. Right away, she has reached the puberty age, where the prayer has become mandatory, where fasting has become mandatory. It's not optional anymore. Same with the boys, whether boys or girls, upon seeing what's known as a wet dream, accompanied by discharge, sexual discharge, in this case, that person have reached the puberty age. Hajj has become mandatory upon them if they do have the means, the financial means and the physical means. There are other signs like reaching the age of 15 if they do not see any of the previous signs for a boy and a girl. If it happened that a person have taken his children with him, boys or girls, at young age, is it okay? Would that Hajj count for them? It would count as a charity, as a voluntary Hajj. As a woman raised her baby child to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, she said, "Ali had a Hajj?" He said, "Yes," and he would receive a reward for that as well. But the question now is whether their Hajj will be enough for the ibadah, which is mandatory, or they still owe Allah another Hajj after reaching the puberty age. Once they've done so many Hajj before the puberty age, these are all charities, voluntary ibadat. But after reaching the puberty age, they still owe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Hajj, which is a mandatory ibadah.
Well, one question that this brings up to me, when you talk about taking the children when they're young, and then also, I assume once they reach the puberty age, if someone's in the habit of doing this or planning to do this, does it count even though the child didn't pay for it himself? And this comes up in other issues as well. Sometimes people might have a sponsorship or a grant or a gift of Hajj. Is this considered sort of cheating that you didn't save the money and spend it yourself? Or does this count as the obligatory Hajj?
Not at all. I would be very happy if you sponsor me to perform Hajj this year. Any person who performs Hajj either out of his pocket, his savings, or a grant from somebody else, his Hajj is well accepted if he follows the same ceremonies and rites that the Prophet ﷺ explained. Concerning the money, where the money is coming from, as long as the money is coming from a lawful source of income, it is perfectly okay, whether it's your money or somebody else's money. As a matter of fact, a person may borrow. He does not have to. He may borrow if he knows that over a period of time, he have the means of paying off the debt, but he does not have to. It's not obligatory upon him to borrow to perform Hajj.
Well, there's also the issue of security. Of course, there's going to be any number of security concerns, probably naturally, in terms of traveling. There's always some uncertainty. You know, we hear about some of the unfortunate events that occur at Hajj sometimes when people are injured. So what is the limits and really the definition of what security means in terms of giving us the opportunity to perform Hajj?
Well, really things have changed big time. We're talking about security in the past where the pilgrims used to travel on the back of the camels, mm-hmm. Being subject of robberies, etc. But now with the airborne, with the ships and, ground transportations, it has become very, very safe. And that's why when a person feels safe, then plus the means of performing Hajj, he or she must perform Hajj.
And the other issue you mentioned was mahram for women. Now, sometimes you'll hear women say, you know, I have everything for Hajj and I want to go, but I don't have a mahram. And they're worried that, you know, because they have the financial, physical capability, that this is going to be sinful for them if they don't go. So they try to find a way to go without the mahram. Can you talk a little bit more about the details of this requirement?
First of all, what is the definition of a mahram? A mahram is a male member of the family of the woman who is either a father, a brother, a son, an uncle, a nephew, or of course a husband. Those people are not allowed to marry to this woman, and the husband is already married to her. So the permanent mahram, a person who can never marry to this woman, he is her mahram. He can travel with her, he can take her places, and she doesn't have to wear and cover her head and face before him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated in one hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, and the hadith is a very, very sound hadith. He said that it is not permissible for a woman to travel 3 days without a male mahram of her family. And in another hadith, Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, also narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said that a man should not stay alone in one place, enclosed area, with a woman who's not his mahram. And a woman should not travel alone without having a mahram with her. So one of the companions was there and he heard the statement of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, O Messenger of Allah, I have been deployed to such and such battle. And my wife set out for Hajj. She's going for Hajj this year. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, go and join your wife. So he changed his direction from going to a battlefield, which is very, very necessary, to the priority is to travel with your wife to give her company. People who watch on the screen, the rites of Hajj, in the crowd around the Kaaba while making tawaf, different areas where they have to spend the night in the streets, such as in Muzdalifah and in Mina and so forth, would definitely recognize the great need for a mahram with a woman.
Sheikh, I'm really glad we were able to give the viewers and of course myself this great introduction to Hajj. I think it's whet our appetite to learn more. And inshallah, when we come back on our next episode, we're going to go into more of the details of actually performing Hajj, inshallah, starting with the preparations before the journey. So please stay with us and tune in again to Hajj Step by Step. And we hope that this will be your authoritative guide for the act of Hajj, inshallah, this year. If not this year, then soon. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.